This is what most people consider to be a cheap AR-15. And this is what most people would consider to be a higher end or an expensive AR-15. And if you didn't know anything about AR-15 brands, aside from the color and the attachments that are on these guns, can you really spot the difference in price just by looking at it? Even if you've researched all the different AR-15 brands and what they have to offer, you're still gonna come up with the same differences between most of them. The biggest differences between them are gonna be claimed accuracy. Number two is gonna be durability, which is gonna be mostly due to the barrel material and the manufacturing processes and the materials used in the bolt carrier group, but more on those in a different video. But the last major difference between an expensive AR-15 and a cheap AR-15 is the feel. Something I've noticed over the past couple of years is higher end ARs simply feel different. The way the trigger breaks and resets, the way the safety clicks on and off, and the way that it recoils. Everything just feels cleaner, snappier, and more well managed in the way that the gun cycles. Thankfully, the good news is you don't need to buy an expensive AR-15 just to get that feel. And so today I'm gonna show you 10 stupid tricks that'll make your cheap AR-15 feel expensive, to the point where when other people shoot it, they have a difficult time discerning the difference between your rifle and a $3,000 rifle.
Yeah, that's very smooth.
And if you see anything in today's video that you want to pick up for yourself, or maybe you want to check the pricing of, first link in the video description, and that link will also be pinned in the comments just in case there's something in this video that catches your interest. In future videos, we will cover how to make your gun as reliable as a high-end AR-15 and how to make it as accurate as one. So if you're not subscribed to the channel, hit the little subscribe button down below and tick notifications. That way you won't miss those videos. So step one for making our AR-15 feel expensive, we need to go to the automotive industry. I know it sounds weird, but hear me out. So in the automotive industry, they like to trick the eye into thinking that you have a much more luxurious interior than you actually do. They do this a couple of different ways, both visually and tactile. They might put some red pinstriping in the interior, maybe some fake carbon fiber, but they really focus on what are called the touch points. And the touch points are things like the way that the steering wheel feels in your hand. Is it soft? Is it leather? Is it suede? They'll even focus on how the buttons react when you click them. There's actually a whole field of research dedicated to the way buttons feel when you click them, the way the shifter feels when you're engaging the gear. They also focus on things like the seats. They want them to feel very nice. They want your armrest to feel really nice. They want your door handles and everything that you touch on a daily basis to feel as luxurious and premium as possible. So what can we learn from this to make our cheap or mid-level AR-15 feel expensive? Picked up this Palmetto State Armory custom AR-15, or their version of a custom AR-15. And it's essentially a standard Palmetto State Armory rifle with a few little upgrades from the factory, one being the Cerakote and two being the trigger. Everything else seems to be the same. I've been shooting the crap out of this gun for the past month and a half, and I've let a couple of friends shoot it. And over that time, I've been very impressed with this gun. I've had no issues with it. It's shot straight and narrow. It's as accurate as I can be, and it's super reliable. However, there are a few things about this gun that I felt needed to be upgraded to make it feel more high-end. So the first touch point that we need to upgrade on our AR-15 is the grip. Maybe you have the standard A2 style grip on your gun that has a little finger groove on there that sometimes gives you a blister. If you like it, fine. But if you want it to feel more high end, we need to change that out. Now there's a few different grips that I like. I'm not gonna go over one particular. I will have a complete list of the ones that I prefer over at the build list. Overall, if you have an AR pistol, you want one that has a more perpendicular grip where it's angled straight down. Whereas if you have a rifle, it doesn't matter if it kicks out a little bit. And that's all due to the length of pull and how your wrists are set up. So if you don't know which angle you prefer, I prefer getting the adjustable grips. I've only tested two adjustable grips. I haven't tested them all. The first one I tested is from Strike Industries. I actually really like the way it feels. I was really surprised by this one. I really like the texture on it. It feels really nice in the hand, and it's really simple to adjust the angle of it. It keeps an Allen wrench in the grip portion of the gun. You can pull it out, put that little Allen wrench in and turn it and change the angle of the grip. The downside is the grip feels loose. It doesn't feel that good, and therefore I just don't recommend it. And then I tested one from a company called Battle Arms Development. They make one that's very similar in regards to being adjustable in the grip, but the downside to it is the grip texture is a little bit slippery and there's not a place to store a tool in the grip itself. Not that you're gonna be changing it that often. Once you get the grip angle set, you're gonna set it and forget it. So maybe they thought you don't need a place to store a tool. But nonetheless, the texture still leaves a little bit to the imagination. I guess you could choose to have it stippled if you wanted to, or you could put a set of talon grips on it. I'll have links over at the build list for different types of grip tape that you can put on AR grips, but nonetheless, I haven't tested them all. I am going to be testing more, but the grip is the main thing that your hand is touching. And so therefore we need to give it a more premium feel. My advice is to go with a Hogue grip. I only have one Hogue grip on one of my rifles because I'm always trying to test different things. But if I didn't have this YouTube channel and I was wanting to set up all my rifles to be perfect, I would have a Hogue grip on every single rifle. They are that comfortable. And they offer a bunch of different angles and different types of grips that will make your gun feel amazing. The second touch point that can make or break your rifle in regards to feeling cheap or expensive is your safety selector. Most AR-15s, unless they're considered like a Gucci brand, come with a standard mil-spec safety selector. The PSA rifle did have an upgraded ambidextrous safety on it. However, I didn't like it on my trigger finger side of the gun. Whenever I depressed the safety, it would hit my knuckle and almost prevent me from disabling the safety. And that really bugged the crap out of me. So I started exploring different safeties. Now there is one safety that just seems to be a notch above all the other safety upgrades that you can do to your gun. And I discovered this one by accident. A couple of years ago, Facts and Firearms sent me their FX5500 lightweight AR-15. And this is an AR-15 that you would consider to be high end. And it really is. And it came with Radian ambidextrous safety. And the safety is just perfect for coming from low ready to firing position or going from high ready to firing position and being able to defeat the safety and depress the trigger simultaneously. But I already knew that. And so I wanted to test a couple of other safeties. And so I picked up this safety from Battle Arms Development, and it has one side that is shorter and one side that is longer. The longer side is for your thumb. The shorter side is on the side of your finger. And thankfully, I can depress this safety without it hitting the knuckle of my trigger finger. And there are many other types of safeties that are available to upgrade on your AR-15, but these two, the Battle Arms Development, as well as the Radiant, have proven to be my top favorites to make your gun feel more high-end and to make it faster for defeating your safety and re-engaging your safety. The third touch point we're gonna upgrade is our handguard. All handguards look alike, but they're not all created the same. And when I'm talking about upgrading a handguard, I'm not worried about if it's key mod or M-lock. To me, I don't have any issues with either one. They both hold my attachments on securely. And I've tested quite a few different handguards on my guns in the past. And my two favorites to date are gonna be the Strike Industries Gridlock Light Rail. I really like this rail because it has a couple of things that I find are important. Number one, I like handguards that don't have Picatinny that go all the way across, because I can always add Picatinny attachments if I need to put an attachment somewhere. But I find that it really helps me grip the firearm much better if the majority of the top of the rail doesn't have Picatinny on it. I like a little bit of Picatinny at the front and a little bit that is close to the receiver just in case my scope mount or red dot mount needs to hang over the upper receiver a little bit. But the second thing that I like about the Strike Industries is it has a quick detach. And this is important, especially for people who have adjustable gas blocks and are trying to tune their gun while they're at the range. You simply just pull this little latch down and it slides right off. Then you can tweak your gas block and put it right back on. They can be had in a bunch of different sizes depending on your rifle. I currently have it set up on my 300 Blackout AR pistol along with their muzzle brake, and it gives it this nice flush look when I'm using the redirection device, which we'll cover those here in a few minutes. But my all-time favorite handguard for AR-15s is the Aero Precision Atlas S1. Now, although this one doesn't have a quick detach function like the Aero Precision, this one has every feature that I want on a handguard. But in addition to that, it is one of the thinnest rails that I've ever held in my hands. It's really hard to explain how good this feels unless you actually try one. Now, these just happen to be my top two favorites. However, the important thing is maybe you have an AR-15 that has one of the old school A2 gas blocks with integrated front sight. You can eliminate that and get a low profile gas block and get a free floating handguard. And from what I understand, when you have a free floated handguard, you have a more accurate rifle because the handguard no longer makes contact with the barrel when you're actually out firing it. Now, the fourth touch point that we need to talk about is our charging handle. There are a lot of good charging handles and there's a lot of basic charging handles. In the case of this Palmetto State Armory rifle that I just picked up, it came with a standard charging handle and those work just fine. However, they can always be improved upon. Once I mounted the scope on this gun, it made it a little bit more cumbersome to actuate the charging handle and pull it, especially if you're at a weird angle. Now, one of the downsides to your standard mil-spec charging handles is the pin. And that little pin right there is the weakest point of the charging handles. And you can see how thin it is in the mil-spec version. And those are known to fail. And so when you're thinking about upgrading your charging handle, you don't have to, but I like to get something that's ambidextrous and something that has a pin that's a little bit more robust. That way it's gonna last a little bit longer. And these charging handles can come in a bunch of different sizes and flavors. One of my favorites is the Radian charging handle. Radian was probably the first company to really pioneer the way that charging handles are designed, especially in ambidextrous. The second one is the CMMG charging handle, which I'm sure is probably made by Radian. Don't quote me on that, but it seems like that it is. My third favorite is the Warhammer. Now, this one is probably the most affordable of the ones that I'm gonna mention today. And it's a really good ambidextrous charging handle, nice and lightweight. However, for $39, this thing is a heck of a deal. I'll have a link over at the parts list if you wanna check that out. But my all-time favorite to date right now is the Battle Arms development charging handle, and it functions completely differently than anything else. It's almost on this weird hinge design. When you pull one side, the other side moves in the opposite direction and vice versa. Whereas most charging handles, when you pull them, both latches move simultaneously in the same direction. But that isn't what makes it my favorite. What makes it my favorite is the way that the actual handle is designed when you go to pull it. It's much thicker and robust, and I find that the experience of charging it is much nicer. But not only that, they don't use those little roll pins that the other charging handles use. They have two Allen bolts on the bottom that are Loctited into place. They swivel on a spring. Over my testing, I haven't had these back out or anything. I'm sure if you ever remove them and you didn't re-Loctite them, they might back out, but I haven't had any bad experiences as of yet. But it is definitely my favorite, but you can take your pick, do your research, and find out which charging handle you think you might like the best. The fifth touch point that we really need to upgrade is the trigger. Now, fortunately, in the case of my Palmetto State Armory rifle, it did come with an upgraded trigger and it feels really nice. Triggers we're gonna be talking about today, the Palmetto State trigger is gonna be the cheapest one and they can be bought separately. It is $99 and it is a single stage 3.5 pound AR-15 trigger. However, I haven't modified anything in the internals of this Palmetto State rifle and mine pulls at 2.5 pounds. But there is one thing that I don't like about this trigger, and I feel like the reset is a little bit weak. And what I mean by that is when you're releasing the trigger, I feel like my finger is almost moving faster than the trigger itself. For me personally, I like a trigger that kind of pushes my finger out. You know, my all-time favorite of AR-15 trigger upgrades is Geissele. But like I mentioned earlier, they're quite pricey. So my all-time favorite trigger upgrade for the money is Velocity triggers. But what I love about their triggers is this. Now they have a bunch of different options that you can get, a bunch of different trigger shoes that you can get. You can get them as single stage, double stage, you can get them as 3.5 pounds or 4.5 pounds, and they just seem to be the best middle of the road trigger personally for me. Another trigger I like are the CMC drop-in triggers, and I've tried both the curved as well as the flat trigger, and I definitely prefer the flat AR-15 trigger. Now, I've tested way more AR triggers than what I've mentioned in this video. I just don't have time to get into them, and there's a lot of them that I like. I really haven't found one that I dislike. It just kind of comes down to what you think is good for the money, which I've already talked about, and what kind of feel you want. Do you want a single stage or do you want a double stage? I personally, for me, like double stage triggers, but if you like to shoot long range and try to get those 1,000-yard shots, then maybe a double stage is best for you so you can prep the trigger and pull through without disrupting your sights. The next touch point we need to look at is our buttstock. Now, there are many different buttstocks out there depending on what your application is. If you're going for long range, you can get something that's crazy and technical and has all the leveling on it so you can shoot prone or shoot from a rest and be able to shoot those 1,000-yard shots with no problem. Or maybe you want something that's a lot smaller and compact and your goal is to get something that's lightweight, or maybe you like something that has a good cheek weld on it. On the Palmetto State Armory rifle that I picked up, it came with your standard Magpul Mo-Butt stock. And this is probably my least favorite butt stock of any butt stock that I've ever tested because it's really, really rattly. It just jiggles around and bugs the crap out of me. Some people have told me that if you put a little bit of duct tape on your buffer tube, you can tighten that gap and it won't slop around anymore. But again, the theme of this video is to make your gun feel more high end. Seeing duct tape doesn't make your gun feel high end. So we're gonna disregard that, but if that's something you wanna do, put some duct tape on your buffer tube and have at it. Now, one of my favorite budget friendly options is probably the Mission First Tactical stock. I really like those. They're small, they're lightweight, they look dead sexy, and they're affordable. Some of my favorite butt stocks include the Magpul STR, which is what I chose to upgrade the Palmetto State Armory rifle with. I really love the cheek weld on this gun. It feels absolutely stunning, and it has a friction lock on it. That way you get zero wobble. A couple of other favorites are the B5 Systems butt stock. That one feels really nice. I like how you don't have to reach your finger between anything to actuate it like you do on the Magpuls. It's super easy just to grab it and move it really quick. So that makes it really nice. However, I will say this, in my experience, the B5 is a little bit wobbly, but it's not as wobbly as the Magpul Mo. I mean, that thing is just the worst. Of the different buttstocks that I have tested, I will have to say that my favorite so far has to go to BCM, Bravo Company. That one basically takes the B5 Systems design and makes it super tight, like the Magpul STR, without a friction lock. So you get the speed, the access of actuating it, and it's lightweight, has a good cheek weld. It just has the best of all the different features that I want of the different buttstocks that I've tried so far. However, I will say this, I have yet to try Daniel Defense. I've been trying to get in touch with them for almost a year now. No one's been answering my emails, so I'm trying to figure out a way to get in touch with them so we can do it. But one thing that stands out about Daniel Defense is their furniture, mainly your touch points with the buttstock, the grip, even the forward grip. And you can buy these separately or you can buy them as a kit. I'm probably gonna buy one of these kits and put it on another gun just to see how they feel. However, I'm sure I'll probably get a lot of hate for that for trying to make a clone of a Daniel Defense, even though that's not my goal. But they do have some really good looking parts for their guns. I just don't know how they feel yet. So if it's something you want to buy, you're buying it at your own risk, but I've heard nothing but great things about them. We need to focus on is our forward grip, AKA hand stop. And depending if you have a rifle or a pistol, it depends on which one you might get. Being the vertical foregrips, I wouldn't put them on anything under a 16-inch barrel or a 14.5-inch pin and welded barrel. There's a lot of good ones out there. However, I really like getting some kind of hand stop or vertical grip out there. That way, when I'm out shooting, I can really pull the gun tighter into my shoulder and mitigate the recoil and make sure that my accuracy is on point. And they feel just absolutely stunning. Some of my favorites include the BCM forward grip. This one is really nice. You can flip it around, super lightweight. It attaches to M-Lock or key mod without the use of a rail section, which I think is huge. And they're not that expensive. They feel really nice. That is definitely my favorite, but there are others that I like as well. Like this red one that I picked up off of Amazon. I don't remember the brand of it, but it is held up like a champ. I'll find the link that I have to it because I included it in a video from a couple of years ago. But that thing was only like probably $20 and it's held up so well and it looks good at the same time. Another one that I've recently tried that I really like is the Strike Industries angled vertical grip. And it comes in a couple of different flavors. It comes in a short one or a low profile and it comes in a longer one. And it has this notch cut out on it. You were putting your gun up to a ledge and you wanted to rest it on the edge of say like a concrete wall or something like that. You can do so. Not that I'm doing it that often, but it's there in case you want it. It locks up really good. The only downside that I have to say about it is you must get a Picatinny rail section in order to attach it. I really wish they would make it where it attaches directly to M-Lock or key mod, but they don't. Another one from Strike Industries that I recently tried that I'm really digging is their bikini hand stops. Now these come in a pair and you can set them up however you want. You can put them on the side of your rail for your thumb to rest on, or you can put them both underneath. These are the ones that I chose to put on my Palmetto State rifle because one, they're super easy to attach without any rail sections. They're really configurable to be custom to wherever your arm feels the most comfortable. And they're incredibly lightweight. They only weigh like a couple of ounces each. And to me, having the front of my gun super light is more important than having a bunch of things attached to my gun. Now that covers the touch points, but there's still a couple of other things that we need to do to make our gun feel more expensive. So the next one is gonna be receiver slop. A lot of AR-15s that come with forged receivers are gonna get receiver slop, even if they're higher end, because the forging process isn't perfect. So if you want a perfect lockup, you're gonna have to get something that's CNC'd. However, I will say this, I've had really good luck with this PSA rifle as it has zero slop between the upper and the lower receiver despite being forged. PSA does offer another rifle very similar to this that cost a couple hundred dollars more that is CNC'd upper and lower if you want to spend the extra money. But if you don't want to spend the extra money on a CNC'd set, there is ways around it. The first option is the O-ring method. And the way it works is you find an O-ring. You can buy a pack of them on Amazon of different sizes, but I've found that if you just take the O-ring off of a threaded Glock barrel or something like that, that tends to be the perfect size. And what you do is you separate your upper from your lower. You then take the front lug of your upper receiver. Then when you're reassembling the gun, you lock the front pin first and lock the rear pin second. And you will see a dramatic increase in the tightness between your upper and your lower receiver. Another cheap, affordable method is to take an earplug and stuff it right where your rear takedown pin is. Then the rear lug of your upper receiver can crush it, and you push it down tight enough to push the rear pin through, and that will also dramatically reduce your receiver slop. However, they're not my favorite methods for a couple of reasons. Number one, with the O-ring method, the moment you put it in and lock it, it's gonna snap the O-ring and you're gonna have to replace it. So anytime you separate the upper and lower, you gotta put a new O-ring in. That's kind of annoying. With the earplug method, I don't like it because every time you take it apart, you're gonna have to find the earplug, and then over time, it's obviously gonna wear out really quickly. So one of my favorite methods is the AccuWedge. I don't have one to show you right here. I've ordered one, I'm just waiting for it to arrive. But the AccuWedge, although it is disposable and doesn't last forever, it will last a heck of a lot longer than your front O-ring or your earplug in your receiver set. And so for me, I think that that's probably gonna be the best bet, is to get some kind of wedge. I will have links to that at the build list if you wanna check it out, but that will dramatically reduce the receiver slop, making your gun feel more high-end and expensive. So now that we got the gun feeling more expensive, when we touch it, grab it, and press out, how do we actually make it feel more expensive when we're shooting it? One of the biggest differences that I've noticed between the way an expensive gun shoots and a cheaper gun shoots is the recoil. And I could go into a whole video on managing the recoil of a gun and making it feel smoother, but for time's sake in today's video, we're gonna limit it to one thing that you can do to make it shoot like an expensive gun. And that's gonna be a muzzle brake. If you're new to the AR-15 or guns in general, the muzzle brake essentially takes the gases that come out the end of the barrel and they redirect them in a different direction, preventing muzzle rise. And there's a ton of really good muzzle brakes out there. Most of your affordable AR-15s are gonna come with what's called a standard A2 flash hider. And they work quite well at hiding the flash. And that's very important, especially if you're shooting with night vision or if you're in a position where you're needing to shoot your gun and not give away your positioning at night, you might wanna hide your flash. For me, I really like a muzzle brake because it makes the gun shoot much flatter. Although 5.56, 2.23, all that stuff doesn't have high recoil, the muzzle does tend to rise as you're shooting the gun, especially when you're shooting it fast. So having a muzzle brake dramatically flattens it out and makes it feel amazing. Some of my favorite muzzle devices are gonna be the three-prong flash hiders that also help reduce muzzle rise. The Lantac Dragon, it's a beast and I love it to death. They are harder to find in stock, but they are amazing and totally worth the money. Esteban Machine is probably someone you've never heard of. I've reviewed them in the past. I have one on both an AR-15 as well as an AR-10 308, and it dramatically reduces the recoil. The most recent muzzle brake that I've tested is the Thumper from Battle Arms Development. And that's the one that I ended up putting onto my Palmetto State Armory rifle. It shoots really nicely. It's really flat and you can really, you know, do some double taps and triple taps, no problems at all. And it feels much flatter than it does with a standard A2. Now, one thing you are gonna have to keep in mind when you're getting a muzzle brake for an AR-15 is it's gonna shoot a lot of concussive forces out to the sides. So unless you're outside shooting, you're really gonna piss off a lot of people at the indoor ranges. Even if you're outside shooting and you got someone on a firing line beside you, it's still gonna hurt their ears even when they're wearing ear pro, because they're gonna feel the wind of the concussive forces hitting them. So it's important to think about getting a blast redirection device. For example, the VG6 Epsilon 5.56, they also make them in other calibers, but you can buy a cage device separately and it helps redirect all the blast forward downrange, not to your sides, but you don't lose that much of the compensation when you put it on. I really like the VG6 cage because it's very low profile. It doesn't stick out like a sore thumb and it locks on with Allen screws, and I've never had one come loose as of yet. The Landtac Dragon also makes a blast forwarding device called the BMD. I don't have one, I haven't tested it, but they are available separately. But now you're talking about spending another $160 on top of the cost of the compensator, but Landtac is worth it. I have to give it to them. Now, if you already have a muzzle brake or compensator on your gun and it doesn't have a proprietary blast forwarding device, there is one other option for you. It's called the Indian Creek Design BFD, which stands for blast forwarding device. I've actually had this since 2016. Indian Creek Design, I don't even know if they're still around. I'm assuming they are, and if they are, I will link it in the parts list. But essentially, it comes with a screw section that goes behind your muzzle device, and then this universal piece screws right on. The downside to it is when you do use this, you lose all your compensation. But if in a pinch, if you're at the indoor range and you don't feel like going out and buying another compensator that comes with a proprietary blast forwarding device, I will say that it works really well at preventing side blast. It just reintroduces recoil. Now, I could go into a full video about each of these upgrades that we've mentioned today. I'm just barely scratching the surface. I'm sure there's a question that you have in your mind that I wasn't able to cover in today's video. So if you have that question, leave it down in the comments. And I really hope that this helps you take your AR-15 that's affordable or cheap or mid-grade and make it feel expensive. Now, another way that you can make your gun feel and look more expensive is by upgrading the bolt carrier group, which I have a dedicated video for right here on how to choose a bolt carrier group, because there's a lot that actually goes into it, not just with the brand, but with the materials used in the manufacturing process. So I highly recommend that you watch that if you haven't already. And in the near future, we're gonna talk about choosing the right barrel, barrel profile, twist rate, materials, all that stuff. So make sure you hit the subscribe button if you're not already. But until next time, guys, I love you. You guys stay sexy.